whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands, praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. You are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I cried, you hold in your hand. Never left my side, and though my heart is torn, I praise you in this storm.
Amen. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Somebody's had more coffee than I have had this morning. So it is good to see you this morning. And how appropriate to start off our service with a song called Storms, when that is the beginning of our series this week. And thankful that God gives us the chance to worship together and to be together. You know, as a pastor, when you start to hear things like the COVID thing flaring back up and all that stuff, you just go, not today, Satan, not today. We are going to be together with God's people. So we're going to continue to pray that stuff away and pray that God would remove that from us. But just want to give you all a few announcements this morning. Want to remind you about next Sunday. Next Sunday is a big day. You may not realize it, but next Sunday is a really big day. Next Sunday, we relaunch Sunday school. Okay, two people, awesome. Rest of you, we'll miss you. But we relaunched Sunday school. That's a big deal. We haven't had Sunday school in over 18 months from last count I had. So Sunday school's coming back, praise God. If you have not signed up for a class yet, you still got one last week, okay? So you got the rest of this week. There are four classes available. If you haven't signed up, you can go to the bulletin board back there and sign up. Or you can go online and sign up and just let you know we will launch into that full force next week. So don't miss it. We want you to be a part of what God's doing. Other thing happening next week as well is this, is we are going to have Family Faith Night Next Sunday night, we are having comedian Paul May, who will be here. The doors open at 5:30, okay? It's 5:30, and it's free, all right? Seriously, free. You got no excuses other than I took a long nap, okay? You're invited, and we want you to invite other people to be with us. This is not going to be just a thing where we say, hey, we want the Grandview folks show up. We want everybody to show up because everybody needs a break from being locked up. And so we want you to come out, have a great time, invite you at 5:30, invite people to join you. I promise you, you won't regret it. A couple of other announcements for you as well. Don't forget, Women's Retreat is coming up in September. You can sign up for that online, or you can get a hold of Megan Fogle. She can help you out with that information as well. We're still collecting T-shirts to be made into jump ropes for Operation Christmas Child boxes. We're collecting winter coats and shoes for our Coats for Christ, which that pickup time was what time? This Wednesday? 3:30 to 6:30. This Wednesday, 3:30 to 6:30, Coats for Christ pickup, or not pickup, technically they're dropping off. You're dropping them off. Also, we're taking shoes. Now, let me go ahead and preface this with shoes. Gently worn shoes, okay? Don't go get your shoes you mowed the grass in and go, hey, we want to give these away, okay? Just be kind to those we're trying to minister to. Also for you, two other real quick things that I want to drop down on you is that we have signed up for the blood drive again. And as of right now, here's the thing. We have to have 17 in order to host the blood drive. Right now, we have one. Thank you, son. And that's me. So, I know some of you can't give blood, and we totally understand that and respect that. But if you can, we ask you to pray about being able to provide that opportunity to give life back to somebody else. And maybe you have a family member, maybe you can't, but you know a family member who can. Invite them to sign up online, or they can come in and let me know, and I'll get them signed up. And the other thing coming up is the Pregnancy Resource Walk for Life. And that is a thing that we as a church have participated in for many, many years. That is on September the 11th. And you can sign up now to support. Right now, I'm walking, okay? I may walk backwards, but I'm going to walk. We're going to get it done. And so we have a sign-up sheet out there where you can sign up to donate to the efforts. At this point, I think I am about halfway to my goal, and I would love by the end of next week to go back and say, hey, I'm going to raise my goal. I'm going to double my goal because the people at Grandview are so faithful to provide in that way. And so if you would like to give, the sign-up sheet is outside the main office door. You can do that right there, or you can go online and do it that way as well. Online is always an option available for you. All right. Whew. Again, I hate announcements, but I need you to know what's going on because what I always hated about you being a youth pastor is people coming to me and going, I didn't know that was going on. And I would go, well, it was on the screen. It was in the bulletin. It was announced. It was online. You got a text message, an email. I sent a smoke signal. And so I don't want you ever to be able to say, we didn't know. So I'm encouraging you. These are the announcements. Also, there may be one or two not listed that are in your bulletin. So please, please, please. Read it. If you need help reading it, I've got some glasses. You can borrow them, okay? Excellent. Well, let's get into our time of prayer this morning. I want to mention just a few specific things of prayer to focus on. Be in prayer for Peg Weebler and her family. Stephanie went to be with the Lord on Saturday. And so she went into hospice on Friday and then went to be with the Lord on Saturday. And so I know that Peg would greatly appreciate your prayers, and the rest of the family would as well. So please, please, please lift them up and let them know. Send her a message, a card. Just check on them, okay? Because we need to check on our folks when we're hurting. And so I want to encourage you to do that. Real quick, I want to give you a few other ones just off the top of my head. Be in prayer for Bob and Ann Walker. Bob is still in the hospital as of Thursday. I have not talked to them since then, but as of Thursday in the hospital, was not doing great. And so just continue to pray for Bob. Pray for Ann as she cares for him and is there beside him and waiting for answers to questions that right now they just aren't getting the answers they're asking for. And so I just encourage you to pray for those things specifically. Other prayer requests, other prayer needs. Yes. Will do. Definitely will do that. If you did not hear that, Joanna said that her brother Rob lost his only daughter this morning. And so y'all be in prayer for that family. Be in prayer that God would give them a peace that only He can. You can't find that anywhere else in this world but in Jesus. Yes, Miss Sonny. Yes, ma'am. Amen. Some of you may not know this, but Miss Sonny broke both of her feet. 2 weeks ago? Okay, so 3 weeks ago then. Broke both of her feet, and then they've also had COVID issues going on in their facility, so she's been unable to be here with us. But she told me the other day when she called me, she said, one doctor says I can't do it, and I know I can, so I'm going to do it. So just pray for Miss Sonny. Praise God that she's back with us today, but pray for healing over her. Yes, son. Yes, my mother is not here again today. You may recognize she did not feel well again this morning, so continue to pray for her. She's in that stage of life where I think, and most of you understand that stage of life, that everything just hurts, and that's where she's at right now. So continue to pray for her. Of course, we want to pray for Linda Liedahl, and praise God to see her here again today. Continue to pray for Linda as she continues to walk through these days that God has given her, and pray for her family. We're thankful for her as a leader and lover in this church. I'm so very thankful for her. Also, yes, Don, I was supposed to say Don's got surgery. Is that what you were going to say, Don? Don has surgery on Thursday. Thank you. I'm going to get my days together eventually. Thursday on his foot. If you want the details, they will tell you. I am not going to tell you because you will never go have surgery. So just pray for Don and Linda as he has the surgery this week. Pray that God would bring healing. God would guide the hands of the surgeons and show compassion from the nurses that deal with them. Any others? Yes. Definitely will. We'll do that. It's okay. God knows, Christina. Y'all would be in prayer for Christina. Christina and Asher, you may recognize Asher's been with us the last couple of weeks, but God is doing a good work in Christina's life, and He is a God who is not only going to start a good work, but He's going to complete a good work. And so y'all pray for Christina and pray for Asher as they go through a difficult season as well. Yes, Beth. If you didn't hear, Beth has two different friends that are going through two different battles. One going through some legal issues and troubles, and the other one in a battle for his life that doesn't believe in the Lord. And so pray for him to come to know Christ through that process. Any others? Yes. Okay. We'll definitely be praying for Rita, praying that God does a mighty work in hearts. God replaces a heart of stone with a heart of flesh, is what His Word tells us. And so we're praying for that. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. We'll continue our time of worship. Father God, you're good. We just need to stop today and confess for a moment that without you, we would be lost. God, without you, we would be nothing. God, we are in a place today where we can openly confess, God, we need you. We're desperate for your presence, God. We're desperate for healing, not just in our bodies, but God, in our hearts. Right now, Lord, I think about the needs that have been lifted up today. God, yes, a lot of them are physical. From surgeries to recoveries. A lot of the hurt we have is physical, Lord, but there is such a deeper burden right now. God, and it is a burden that stems from the battle for our souls. Because we have an enemy that sits today and he says, I want to kill, steal, and destroy anything that the Father's doing. And so, God, we pray right now that you would bind Satan, that you would bind him from this place. God, you would bind him from the lives of the people in this place. God, help us. Help us to cling to you daily. Help us to put on that full armor. And God, help us to bow our knee to your will and your plan for our lives. Father, I pray in this room today that you would turn the hearts of the children to the Father. God, that you would bring about revival. God, that you'd bring about repentance. God, that you would restore hope and restore homes. And God, you'd restore health. God, we pray today in this place that Jesus would be our focus. God, that we would make so much of him that when we leave this place, Lord, the name Jesus would be on our lips. And we would show it in our lives. God, I know that we have so many hurts. But we cry out to the healer. Jesus, would you be here with us today? We love you, Lord. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. And all God's people said together, amen. Would you stand for a time of worship today?
Yeah.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Hold it all together, everybody needs you strong. A life hits you out of nowhere and it leaves you holding on. And when you're tired of fighting, chained by your control, it's freedom in surrender, lay it down and let it go. So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, holding on and just be held. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne, stop holding on and just be held. Just be held. Just be your eyes are on the cross, you know I always have and I always will. Not a tear is wasted, time you'll understand. Turning beauty within the ashes, life is in my hands. So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone, stop holding. Just be. never chose me. It's always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong. And there's a rush. It's hardly ever my price. It's all I never did it right. But it turns out they're the ones who were looking for all this time. So I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody. My soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. And for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. And for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. When Moses had stage fright, came from a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders, nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking, tell me who did it with the bar. I'll say I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm waiting for the world.
Good morning. You know, during the Daniel series, I was constantly getting asked about our intro video. People were like, I love the intro video. Who did that? And I was like, I bought it. And as we were preparing to jump into this series, I approached one of our resident technology geniuses. Is he in the room? Because I'm just checking. Okay. Drew Stroud was, and I was like, hey, man, can you put me together a video? Everybody really liked the Daniel one, so I kind of got to have one this time. And that was the work of Drew. So Drew didn't ask for that, but he deserved it. He put a lot of hard work into that. So praise God for people who have talents, because I don't. So thank you, Drew, for that. I greatly appreciate it. You know, there's an old saying that says you're either in a storm, you're going through a storm, or you're fixing to go into a storm. In the South, we say fixin' to as one word. But You've probably heard that statement before. And the reality is that is probably one of the most true statements of your life, right? You're either walking in one right now, you just left one, or you can see one on the horizon and go, oh no. As a child, I would stand on my grandparents' back porch looking over the beehives and the garden and watch the storms rolling in. And I would watch the lightning and I would listen to the thunder and I would sit there and just be like super excited. And my grandmother would like, get inside, we got to get in the bathtub. Because evidently that's what you do when storms come. I did not know that. But can I tell you, as I've gotten older, I'm not as fond of storms as I used to be. And I mean that both in life and in meteorology. Because I've seen some terrible things. It seems like no matter what, it's either raining on you, behind you, or in front of you. And look, in this area, there should not be a question about, do you know what a flood looks like? I asked that question of Doug Howard when we were preparing to move here. I said, Doug, I know that we're not too far from the Mississippi River. There's lots of floods on the river. Do I need to live far away from the river? When was the last flood? Remind you, this is 2020 when this happens, and there was a flood in 2019. Doug said, I don't know. I think it's been a while. You know, actually, Iowa is notorious for that. Iowa is notorious for flooding. In fact, I saw this in 2019. It became official that every county in the state of Iowa has had to file for emergency relief because of flooding. Every county. All 99 counties. And I was astounded by that. And look, you have no understanding about what it's like to not have a flood. In 1927, at the time that it was the greatest flood in the history of the United States, 1927 happened, guess where? Iowa. Specifically, Des Moines. Which I didn't even know that was possible. 1993. Oh, now you're like, yeah, I know that one. Because I don't think many of you are around in 1927. But you're like, yeah, I know that one. 1993. Oh, my goodness. Oh, I got to read the statistics because I don't want to lie to you, okay? The flood covered 9 states. 400,000 square miles. It lasted in some locations up to 200 days. 50 people lost their lives. 55,000 people were left homeless. And it is considered the most financial devastating flood in history. $16 billion of damage. Floods are devastating. And they always bring about change. See, today we're going to look at the first flood, the greatest flood. The one that you've probably read 100 times in children's Sunday school or read to your kids out of an illustrated Bible. Or maybe you've even had your kids dress up like animals from it. Yes, Johnny. Hurricane Katrina was a very bad one. It was not specifically related to just a flood. Hurricanes are bad. And we'll actually talk about hurricanes in our next Sunday. Did you read my sermon for next Sunday already? Okay. Just checking. But the reality is that storms are something we all face. And the scary thing is not the storm. It's the after effect. And I hear all the time these questions asked to me, Pastor, why am I going through this? What did I do to deserve this? Is God mad at me? When will this be over? How am I going to survive this? Can I just tell you today that I do not always have the answers to these questions? But He does. And so today we're going to see what God has to say about the flood. Would you stand with me as we read from Genesis chapter 6, starting in verse 5. I do want to warn you, this is a long portion of Scripture today, so if you need to stay seated because of health reasons, please do. Verse 5 says this: "The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted that he made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, 'I will blot out man, whom I have created, from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I made them.' But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord." These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. Noah walked with God. And Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. "Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence. And God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth." Folks, the word "corrupted" was used three times in that little verse. Okay? Get it. It's messed up. "And God said to Noah, 'I have determined to make an end to all flesh, and for the earth is filled with violence through them. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and out with pitch. This is how you are to make it: the length of the ark 300 cubits, and its breadth 50 cubits, and its height 30 cubits. Make a roof for the ark and finish it to a cubit above. And set the door of the ark in its side. Make it with lower, second, and third decks. For behold, I will bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh, which is the breath of life under heaven. Everything that is on the earth shall die, but I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall come into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, your sons' wives with you, and everything, living thing of all flesh. You shall bring two of every sort into the ark to keep them alive with you. They shall be male and female. Of the birds according to their kinds, and of the animals according to their kinds, of every creeping thing on the ground according to its kind, two of every sort shall come in to you to keep them alive. Also take with you every sort of food that is eaten and store it up. It shall serve as food for you and for them." Noah did this. He did all that God commanded him. Father, today as we look at this story of the flood, God, will we see today your heart? God, will we understand the purpose and the plan? And God, will we focus on the promise that is coming? Lord, we thank you for familiar stories. But we also thank you, God, for new truths. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. As you're being seated, I do want to remind you that there is a digital guide online for you. If maybe you want to have some extra resources, there's about 8 extra resources on there this week of some other videos specifically about the flood, specifically about Noah's Ark. There's some really cool stuff with Ken Ham. If you don't know who that is, Google it. All right, Ken Ham is a genius, does the Genesis stuff and is amazing, so I would encourage you to look up some information on that. I want to just point you in those resources because I don't ever want you to leave this place and go, "Well, I got all the Jesus I need until next week." Because you need Jesus every day, all day. And so I want to point you to those resources so you can use those. This flood story, again, is probably one of the most, it's a children's classic, right? I mean, we've got it painted on walls and around here. And we look at it and we go, oh, how neat. And the kids even have little playset toys. I remember our kids having the little boat and they had little animals they could put in the boat. And it's like, oh, this is a really sweet story. Can I just go ahead and tell you that no time when there's a storm in Scripture is it sweet? Never. There's always something deeper than just the animals got on a boat. I mean, a lot of you put your dogs on a boat every time you go out to the river. Are you an ark? No. Some of you shook your head yes. I apologize. We'll talk about that later. But as we look at this today, we're going to pull apart three chapters of Scripture. Now, I know you're going, so good, Sunday school starts next week. That way we're on time. Okay. But we're going to get this out today because we're going to walk through real quickly three things that I believe God wants us to see in our storms. The first one I want to see today is this. Number one, God grieves. This is something we need to understand about the storms we go through, the battles we face in life. Verse 6 says this, "The Lord regretted He made man, and it grieved Him to His heart." How bad was the world that God, the one who is pure joy, was sad? I mean, the word grieved means to experience deep sorrow. God was not just like, oh man, I got to tear the Lego creation down and build it back. I got to redo the Play-Doh. That's not what God was doing. God was sitting there in deep, deep sorrow. But can you understand why, though? I mean, can we understand why God was in such great sorrow? Some of you can, and the rest of you are still sitting there quietly, so I'm going to assume you need me to tell you the five reasons God was in great sorrow. Here they are. Verses 5 and 11 through 12 give us five reasons. It says this, "The wickedness of man. Every intent of the thoughts of man's heart was only evil continually." Now, that's a big statement, so I'm just going to get that out there. Everything that ran through their minds was bad. You understand that? Let's just have a moment of confession today. We're going to be like our brethren today over in a different church. We're going to confess for just a moment. Anybody had a bad thought today? Okay, some of you, I understand you don't want to confess you've had a bad thought, and that's okay. Jesus loves you still. How many of you have had more than one bad thought today? And some of you are like, preacher, if you go to a third, I ain't raising my hand. Here's the thing, one thought, two thought. You know, we can live with occasionally having a bad thought, having a negative thinking pattern. But what it says here is they thought everything continuously evil. There was no good in their thoughts. Even a bad person can have a good thought once a day. These people thought evil continually. The word continually means without stop. They never stopped thinking evil. So wickedness of man, continuously thinking evil. The earth was corrupt. Not even just the people, but the world. The actual planet had been corrupted by people. That's how bad it was. Oh, we're not done yet, though. The earth was filled with violence. Think about it. If everybody's evil and everybody's thinking evil things, then what are they doing? Evil stuff. And then the fifth one says, all flesh had corrupted their way upon the earth. All flesh. God wasn't just going to destroy the people. He was going to destroy the animals. All flesh had been corrupted. My goodness, why would God not be upset? Think about it. He created people to have a relationship with Him in His image, and they were being everything but like Him. So did God have a right to bring destruction? Yes. God had every right. But see, we need to understand that bringing the flood was not about God being delighted in what he did. God didn't bring, didn't stand up in heaven and send the rains and go, ha, 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 ha. You know, you've seen those, or maybe you were that kid. I don't know if you were or not. If you were, please don't tell me. But you've seen the things of kids with like magnifying glasses, burning ants. Sometimes people picture God like that. Because the kids doing that are always laughing and snickering. Like, ha, ha, ha. Let's see, our God does not sit in heaven and watch you suffer and go, yes. The scriptures say that he grieved. He grieved. He was sorrow-filled. Not just sorrowful, but sorrow-filled. It grieved God that his creation would have to go through this. Can I tell you right now, if you're going through a battle, if you're going through a storm, God is not up in heaven going, ha ha, let's see how they make it. Because I hear from people all the time, is God mad at me? See, God took his wrath out on the cross. He took his wrath out on the cross. He's not taking anything out on you. Do you deserve to have him take stuff out on you? I'm glad we got that figured out. The truth is this, is God grieves when his children face battles. God grieves when he knows that your heart is hurting. And this may seem like something you can't understand, but if you've ever been a parent, you understand that. When your kids go through difficult times, when your kids go through hard battles, do you not hurt too? And the first instinct you and I often have is let's fix it for them, right? Am I the only parent?
Hello?
Thank you. Just checking. I know most of you got kids because I've seen them. But when my kids are going through difficult times and they've made poor decisions that have led to poor outcomes, you know what? I want to go in and I want to rescue them. But I have had to learn this, that sometimes my heart has to break for their heart to be fixed. And the heart of God is not to bring pain into your life. The heart of God is to fix your life. And sometimes you have to walk through the pain to be fixed. Don, you're going to have surgery this week. Can I just go ahead and warn you, it's going to hurt for a couple days? But at the end, it's going to be what? Fixed. See, God allows us to go through these moments, and it breaks his heart that we have to. See, when God's children walk through storms, it grieves him. It grieves the heart of the Father, but I need you and God needs you to hear this. The floods, the storms, the destructions, the tearing down, he has a plan. He has a plan. God doesn't walk through anything and not know what's going to happen on the other side. That's part of number two. Number two, God has a rescue process. God has a rescue process. See, if the declaration that God was sending the destruction was the end of the story, wouldn't that be terrible if the Bible just ended at Genesis 6, 7? So the Lord said, I will blot out man and everything that I've created from the face of the earth. Man, animals, creeping things, birds, heavens. I'm sorry, I've made them and they're done. Wouldn't that have been a terrible book? You would not be reenacting that. We wouldn't even be here to reenact it. But see, that's the great thing, is the story doesn't end right there. The story doesn't just stop there. See, God would have been right if he'd have ended the story. God would have been just if he'd have said, you know what? We're done. I tried it. It's finished. I'm done. See, God doesn't owe us a rescue. We have willfully violated his law. We've willfully hated our brothers and sisters. Remember that Jesus says that to hate someone is to murder them. We've done what is wrong in God's eyes and called it right. God has every right to say enough is enough and we're done. But I want to draw your attention to verse 8. Look at that first word. But. I know I've said this like three times in the last couple weeks. That's one of my favorite words in Scripture. Because it always tells us that something's about to change. That this has happened, but this is coming. And this is what we get. God looks at creation and he says, this hurts. I don't like it. I got to change it. And what does God do? He says, but Noah. See, he finds Noah, a man who is righteous, a man who is blameless. And those words don't come up often in the Scripture. That someone's right and blameless. See, we need to always stop and recognize when the word shows up, when it says, but God has a plan. See, Noah walked with God, and because Noah walked with God, he could be part of God's plan. God knew that people needed to face punishment. Can we just, for a moment, recognize and admit this? And I think we have to stop. Whatever you're thinking about this moment, and I know you're thinking about lunch, whatever you're thinking about, just think, for this moment, all the storms, all the trials, all the battles, all the hurts, all the tribulations, do you deserve those? Okay, this side of the room is with me. Come on this side. Okay, some of you are slower getting there. We'll be all right. Maybe I need to stand on this side more often because I do stand on that side more often. Maybe I need to stand over here. Okay. We deserve those things. We deserve every trial we go through. We deserve everything we go through. Look, I hear it all the time, but Pastor, I'm a good person. I love you, and I just need to tell you from the bottom of my heart, no, you're not. I'm not. I'm not good. God is. And see, God has every right to punish us. God has every right to destroy us. But God intervenes. See, God knew he would provide a way out. Provide a way of rescue. See, 1 Corinthians 10:13 tells us that. It says, no temptation has overtaken you that is not common to all mankind. But God is faithful. Thank you. God is faithful. He always provides a way of escape. See, God had a plan, and God was going to rescue the people from his wrath. And I got for you in your notes four parts of the rescue process. Four parts of the rescue process. The person. That's Noah. The person was Noah. The plan. Build a boat. Build a boat. God had the power. See, God had the power to cause the flood, and he had the power to stop the flood. Can you imagine? I just always think about this. I always think it's comical. Can you imagine Noah? Because it tells us in Scripture later on in the New Testament that he's a righteous preacher. So can you imagine Noah? He's not a guy that's gotten this message from God and going, I'm just going to build a boat and leave everybody else alone. I can see him building this boat and everybody going, what are you doing? Rain's coming. What? Rain. Never heard of her. It's going to be water falling from the sky. Noah's crazy. He's done gotten in the vineyard. Those of you that have read the rest of Genesis will understand that reference. He's nuts. No. God is going to send water from the sky. And they think he's crazy. See, part of God's power on display is the rain coming from the sky. Because they'd never seen it before. Up until this point, rain had never fallen. Never. All the water they got came from the ground. In fact, if you recall what Scripture will say a little bit later, we did not read this portion, but it says when the waters began to fall from the sky, water began to come up from the ground. See, God alone has the power. You may recall, God stops rain later on in the Old Testament and says that it's through the prayers of a righteous man that rain stopped. God sends the rain on whom He chooses, but God can stop the floods as well. And the purpose. What was the purpose of this flood? It was to cleanse His creation and restore it. See, God was going to use one who walked with Him. God was going to use a wood structure to seal the salvation of His people. God was going to allow the waters to rise and cause them to fall. God was going to bring healing and life back to His creation. See, they were going through the storm, but God was with them. God had secured them. Do you remember what Scripture tells us of who closed the door to the ark? God did. Because God secured His people. Can I tell you, in the midst of the flood, God secures His people. In the midst of the storms, God secures His people. See, there may have been thunder, but God was there. There may have been lightning. The boat was rocking. But God was still there. Because God's plans never fail. God's plans can't be stopped. God was with them in the midst of their storm. Believer, God is with you in the midst of your storm. In the midst of the marriage that's crumbling. In the midst of the job that you either hate or you lost. He's in the midst of the child who's gone astray. He's in the midst of that teenager that lives in your house. I have one. God is there. See, just like the process from the flood, God has a rescue plan for your life. The person, Jesus. The plan, a wooden cross. The power to defeat death and the grave. The purpose to cleanse sinners and restore right relationship. See, God was the one who walked the earth. Jesus Himself showed up. Jesus was sent to die on a criminal's death on a wooden cross to save His people. And God was going to allow the blood of His Son to flow freely to cover you and me. God was going to bring healing and life to His creation by defeating death. There's a process that God is walking us through. But that's not the end of the story. I've already heard some of our children spout off a little bit about the ark. Can somebody tell me how long it rained? 40 days. 40 days and 40 nights. There are moments in our move to Iowa, I thought it was going to snow for 40 days and 40 nights. 40 days and 40 nights. Do you understand how long that is? 40 days, 40 nights. I read that it took roughly 371 days for the waters to recede from the earth. Thought the flood of 1993 was bad. 371 days. See, chapter 6 lays out the story of why God did what He did. Chapter 7 lays out how they built everything and how God began to bring the flood waters to us. But see, chapter 8 brings us the promise that God has. This is what we have. God grieves. God has a rescue process. And the third point here is this. God has a promise. God has a promise. Verse 21. Verse 21 says this. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in His heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man. For the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I strike down every living creature as I've done And then he says in chapter 9, behold, this is verse 8, chapter 9. Behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living thing that is with you, the birds, the livestock, the beasts of the earth, as many as came on the ark, it is for every beast of the earth. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. Verse 12 says this, and this is a sign of the covenant that I make between me and you, every living creature that is with you for all generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant as between me and you and every living creature, and the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember it. God said to Noah, this is a sign of the covenant that I have established between me and the flesh of the earth. This is something we have to understand. We need to grasp this. This promise that God makes to his people is not that they will never face another storm. The promise that God makes is not that you will ever go through life without facing another trial, or that you'll ever walk through life without another tribulation or difficulty, or without another disease, or without another virus, or without another pandemic, or without another broken heart or broken relationship. The promise that God makes to his people is this, is you may walk through those things, but you will never be destroyed by them. Can I tell you, that's a beautiful promise. That God says to his people, you know what? You will face trials. You will face tribulations, but they will not destroy you. I read this commentary about the rainbow this week. Because the rainbow in our culture is taking a real kick, hasn't it? From both sides, just be honest. But you know, when he says he puts his bow in the sky, it's actually a really neat metaphor. Because what he's doing is a bow is used to shoot arrows, is it not? I'm not a bow hunter, so if I'm doing it wrong, forgive me. But when a warrior hangs his bow up, it goes this way, right? It's a sign of peace. And what our God is saying to us, what our God is telling you and I in the midst of our storms, in the midst of the moments that you go, Lord, I don't know if I can handle it anymore. God is offering you peace. God is offering you peace. Next week, we'll look at Jesus speaking to the storm. As what does Jesus say to the storm? Peace. Be still. See, in the midst of your storms, God is not smiling. God is brokenhearted for your battles. And the purpose of these battles is to draw you to a place of peace that can only be found in Christ. Can you not imagine right now those people that were there in Noah's days, that as the waters came and the waters rose, that they began to freak out and try to climb on to everything they possibly could to survive? I can see it in my head, and I've seen the movies where they portray it, and people are trying to climb onto the ark, and they're trying to climb the mountaintops and climb the trees. Can I tell you, you can climb every mountaintop, but if you're not sealed in Christ Jesus, the floods will take you down. And the only one who can seal you in that is God himself. Because God closes the door and he keeps his people safe. that storm that you're walking through. I don't know what it is. Or maybe I do. Some of you may have told me your storms, and I do know. And I don't know how long it's going to last. But I do love the fact that God had a time the storm started, and He had a day it ended. And not only do we take some solace in the fact that it started and it ended, we need to take peace in this, that God has made a promise. And God never breaks a promise to His people. So in the midst of your storms, in the midst of your floods, hurricanes, tornadoes, God offers peace. Will you accept it? Or will you try to climb every other way to get out of the floods? There's not but one way to safety, and that's Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, I just want to come today, God, admitting that there are storms raging. God, there are winds blowing and thunder clapping and lightning flashing all around us in every single one of our lives. And God, some of us have chosen to stand in the storm instead of seeking the shelter that is Jesus. Father, I don't know how anybody makes it without being protected by You. And God, I just pray today, Father, that those who are drowning, that they would reach out to the Savior. That they would see peace. God, that we would know that right now, as each of us walk through our battles, as each of us struggle in the storms, that You're there with us. That You're watching over us, You're protecting us, and that You love us. Father, we thank You for Jesus. It's in His name we pray. Amen. You stand for a time of response today.
You give life, You are love.